for us. You can have a seat. I'm going to have you stand back up in a second, but what I need you to do is get your Bibles in your hand, okay? Find the book of Colossians. We're going to continue on our series in Colossians, and here's what I found to be true. It's been so helpful for me as we have been working through these troubling days in our church to have a book that reminds us of these truths. This series has reminded us of the supremacy of Christ. Amen? Amen? He created all things. He holds all things together. He reconciles all things. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. Jesus is victorious over all things, and in him we can live victorious. All right? Let's stand back up to our feet, read together these words in Colossians. And every time you see the little phrase that says, in him, I'm going to read it, but every time we get to in him or with him, I want us to say that together loud as a church, all right? So follow with me as I read, starting in verse 8. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elementary spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily. And you've been filled in him who is the head of all rule and authority. In him also you are circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Having been buried with him in baptism, which you were raised with him through faith in the powerful working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh. God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities, and he put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. You can be seated. What a great passage. It reminds us of some things today. And if you're taking notes, the first words I would love for you to fill in, to be reminded of as we look at this topic of today, victorious life in Jesus comes because we are filled in him for victory over worldly influence. We are filled in him for victory over worldly influence. Take a look at verse 8. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit. See to it. How can we experience victory over worldly influence? There's a couple things he gives to us so that we don't fall victim, that we don't fall prey. And one of them is that we would see to it. And what that means is to be watchful, to be on the alert, to be mindful of everything that's going on. We as a people need to be watchful. We need to see to it, on the look, on the ready. And I was trying to think of times when I've tried to help people with that, and I immediately thought of Camp Harvest. And back in the day, I had the opportunity to teach lifeguards all about what to do to be ready if something were to come our way, if something bad were to happen. How could we be ready for? And it was this: be alert, be watchful. Because, man, as a lifeguard, sometimes it's really boring. Sometimes the mundane, you know, that's kind of like our life sometimes. We have the daily mundane, and it's easy to lose sight of things, or it's easy to become distracted, or it's easy to fall asleep at the wheel. And I didn't want any of our lifeguards to fall asleep at the wheel, because the danger that comes with that is it's not returnable. And so you would teach these guys, watch out for this, and look for that, and keep your eyes here, and focused on this. And then you would start to do demonstrations of it, and someone starts to pretend like they're drowning in the water, and they see it, and they go. And another person's cramping on a side while there's someone cruising down the zip line and going down the water slide, and all these things going around. But they were on the watch. They were looking for, so that they would be ready to respond in a right way. And that's what we have to be every day as we think about worldly influences that would like to defeat us, that we have victory, but we have to have eyes that are, see to it, be watchful. The reason is this. Look at the next words. See to it that no one takes you captive. No one, meaning there is a strong possibility that someone will try to lead you astray. Someone will try to deceive you. Someone will try to give you things that are not accurate. And in this day, in the book of Colossians, there were false teachers going around trying to deceive people into believing stuff that wasn't true. They were removing Christ. They were taking things out of context. There were things that were partial truths, and there were some things that were just blatant lies. And Paul is trying to tell them, see to it that no one be watchful, because there are people who are going to want to do this. And there are people who are going to want to do this today in our context. So we have to see to it that no one takes us captive. I've never served in our forces, but I'm fascinated with movies, documentaries, books that talk about war. And I remember reading one book that talked about 513 of our soldiers who had been giving of themselves. They were taken captive. And in this book, it was called Ghost Soldiers. It was a big book. It was describing what it was like to be a POW. And it made me so upset. Someone took them captive. And it described how they would bind them up. It described how that would withhold from them nourishment. It would describe what it was like for their daily routine. It would describe all these things that were horrific. And several times while I was reading that book, I would take it and I would just throw it down. It was so frustrating to read. Yet you have to know that Satan prowls around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And he is going after us. And so we have to see to it that no one takes us captive, because when we are captive, it doesn't look like we're much good when someone's got us bound up. So I want us to experience the victory. How do we experience that victory? How can we have that in our lives? Well, I believe it's something that we can have, but we have to guard ourselves against these things here. In this text, it says that we need to watch out for this. Empty deceit according to human tradition, according to elementary spirits of the world. And I saw that, I thought, well, come on. Does that really happen today? And I thought about just when I was a little kid. And I remember having these, I played a sport called hockey. And my mom would take me to these rinks all the time. And I started to listen to different hockey players because I was fascinated what they do to win games and how they could put things together. And I started to see different things that they would do, and it was kind of like superstitious stuff. And I'm like, well, if it works for them, it'll work for me. And so I remember every day in a locker room, I would put a certain sock on a certain way and then a certain knee pad and this and then the pants. And then as I would go out to the rink, I'd be like, hold on, which skate goes first? Okay, I must go on with my right skate. And how many times do I tap the boards before I go out and skate my first lap around? And had all these things worked up. And you laugh at that, and I do too. I'm like, how superstitious, how silly is that? But it started to flood my mind, and I would do it. And then when we'd lose, I'd have to change the routine, because obviously that routine didn't work. But when I think about us today, and I think about these worldly influences that are trying to take us captive, here's some thoughts that came into my mind. I've heard these stated. I just follow your heart. If your gut tells you to do something, just go with it. It's probably true. Well, I believe that to be true. There are so many people behind this, I think I should just follow them. I've found this to be true. If I have enough good, or fill in the blank, I think I deserve that because, you know, if it doesn't hurt anybody else, it can't be that bad. Can you see how worldly philosophies, can you see how empty deceit can easily creep into our heart? You know what it does? It just takes us captive. But this text says, you want victory over these worldly influences even starting to invade our lives? You do, right? I want victory over that. Here's what he says, be filled. Be filled, where does it say to be filled? In him. Filled in him. Love this, where it says, filled in him. The whole fullness of deity dwells. Whole fullness, that seems like the same thing said twice. Why did he waste a word? Paul doesn't waste words. Well, he says whole fullness because he wants us to know that he's stacking these words for emphasis. How much of God is present in Jesus? All of him. All of him. Nothing diminished. Jesus Christ is unshared in his supremacy. That is such good news for us. In him, we have victory. In Jesus. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And you have been filled in him, who is the head of all rule and authority. There is nothing, there is nobody else above Jesus Christ, filled in him. What a great phrase for us to walk through today and to think about who our identity is in. It is in Jesus. Whether you have a license in your pocket and you pull that out and you see, oh, that's my name. Yes, that is an identity. But that is something that has been given to you by your parents. How much greater is this for our lives to understand that we don't live for your identity, but rather you live from your identity. And if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you can say your name. Mine's John Smith, believe it or not. That's why I carry a passport with me all times, because people don't believe it. They don't believe, but this is my, that's my name. But how many of us, if we were to take a look at this and put inside of our reminder of who we are, when someone asks you your identity, you say, I'm a Christian. I'm a follower of Jesus. I am filled in him. And that's where the fullness comes. That's where the victory is at. And so those are great reminders for us that we need to be reminding ourselves of Jesus in fullness, and then we are filled in him. Well, let's move on to the next phrase here. Not only can we experience victory over worldly influences, Paul is telling us that we can be transformed in him for victory over sin. Verses 11 and 12. In him you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. In him you were circumcised with a circumcision that was made without hands. Spiritual circumcision is what he's talking about. When you look at Deuteronomy chapter 10 or Deuteronomy chapter 30 or Jeremiah chapter 4, it was talking about a physical circumcision of what was to come only through Jesus. Jesus would be the one who provides the circumcision of heart that gives us freedom, that gives us transformation. And so how great is it that it's spelled out before us that the circumcision of heart is Jesus taking the scalpel and perform an open heart surgery and sees our sin, and we call out to him and ask him to forgive us of our sin. That spiritual circumcision takes place and we are wiped of that sin. We are transformed. We are made new. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And so he wants to make things very simple, very clear. We can all have a transformed life. We can have a transformed life and experience victory over sin, but it's through him. It's in him. That's where the spiritual circumcision takes place. And then he goes on to give us another picture that's really important for us to see. He talks about this next phrase, baptism. Having been, verse 12, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in powerful working of God. There is a moment in time when you are baptized spiritually, meaning you gave your life to Christ, you let him carve out the sin, remove that sin, baptized, being filled with the Spirit. And then how about that baptism that we got to see today? Man, I wish the girl could have been a little more clear in what really went on in her life, right? She's like, and here's when I gave my life to Christ, and here's what's going on today, and here's what, and that's what transformation does. Transformation, a spiritual transformation, is a gutting out of the sin. It's giving you new life, and then it's transforming the way that you used to look at things. The way that you used to live is now different because of what Jesus did. Filled in him. Transformed in him. And then having the opportunity to publicly profess your faith, what an encouragement to us as a church. Boy, if you've never done that, I would really encourage you to do that, because that ministers to all of us. Telling your story of when Jesus met you, that's powerful, and that's transformational, and that speaks to us, his children. Third point, alive with him for victory over judgment. Alive with him for victory over judgment. He continues on. Verse 13, you were dead in your sins, but now are made alive in him. Victory over judgment. When you give your life to Christ, when you say, forgive me of my sin, you have victory over judgment. Jesus Christ made the debt disappear. Wow. I don't know how many of you own a house, but when you go to purchase a house, you sign a piece of paper, and what are you hoping someday you'll see? Paid in full. You're like, sweet, the house, it's mine. And you work for it, and you work for it. This is just opposite of that. There's nothing we do to get the judgment released from us. The debt can only be paid in full by what he did. And he's saying, alive in him, we can have this. We can be alive with him for victory over judgment. But it's everything that he has done. So if you were to take that little sheet of paper that you have and you were to put under this point, you were just to put your name, and then you would put born sinful, and then you realize that there's nothing you can do to get to God, what I would do is write Jesus over the top of all of that. Jesus takes upon himself our sin. Jesus did everything for us, nothing we do to get to God. And he wants us to know, Paul wants us to know, Paul wants the people of Colossae to be reminded that alive with him, that he's the one who pays the debt so that we don't have to incur the judgment. He took the nails. He took the beating. He took upon himself our sin that we wouldn't have to experience the judgment. And if we think it's exciting to be able to see something tangible on this earth paid in full, how much greater is it to know that there's nothing we do to get what we so deserve, but he paid for, that we might have a life with him forever. So we, alive, victory over judgment only comes through Jesus, in him. Well, the story doesn't stop there. Take a look at verse 15. He says, he disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. When I think about this, I had to look up and find out, like, what's he trying to get across there? And in this context, what he would talk about is stripping people of their power, rendering them powerless, triumph with him, victory over evil, that Jesus puts them in their place. Like in the day, if there was a king who was taken off the throne and he was rendered powerless, if he came in with a sword, they would take the sword and throw it down, and they would bind him in chains, and they would haul them back to the city where they would pronounce him no longer ruler. Do you know what? Our sin doesn't have to rule us anymore when we give it to Jesus. Our sin doesn't have us captive anymore. We are set free. We can triumph over that, and it's the powers are rendered useless because of what Jesus does. It's in him. It's with him. It's through him. Can you get Paul's train of thought? It's all about Jesus. And we as a church, we can lean into that in these times. We as a church can triumph in that, knowing that Satan, he has no victory. He has nothing that he gets to triumph over. And we have everything that we get to triumph over. Well, just in case that wasn't exciting enough, he finishes this chapter, verses 16 through 23, and he says, therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food and drink or with regard to festival or new moon or Sabbath. These are shadows of things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Choose relationship with him over religion. in this day, there were so many false teachers, there were so many trains of thought that were coming in that Paul just said, once again, watch out for these things. These things can come your way. And so therefore, choose relationship over religion. This first one, when you read those words, it's called legalism. Legalism adds to. If you are in Christ, you are a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. Legalism wants to ask you to take on other things that are extra biblical. Well, listen, if you talk this way, you're more spiritual. If you dress this way, you're more spiritual. If you act a certain way, you're more spiritual. And before long, you start believing that because you've added these things, you're more than what, and you're better than. And what starts happening in your heart and in your mind? You start looking at people differently, and you start judging them, and you start taking things on that are not meant to be yours. And legalism is not focused on Jesus, it's focused on the external. And we just can't ever afford that as a church, just like he was trying to tell the people of Colossae, don't ever put this on. It is not meant for us to be like this. Don't be judgmental. Don't look at people in these ways. It's all about in him and him alone. Don't fall victim to religion. It's relationship. And not only will you judge others, but then you say, man, I don't even know if I can associate with these people. And you can see the downward spiral and the downward spiral of thinking legalism is something that we should take on ourselves. So Jesus over legalism and Jesus over mysticism. In verses 18 and 19, let no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism and worship of angels, going on in detail about visions puffed up without reason by the sensuous mind. And not holding fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and knit together through its joints and ligaments, grows with a growth that is from God. Mysticism. Back in this day, there was a belief that if you thought differently, if you had a higher subjective power, if there was something that you could add to these words, and if you could add to the intellectual capacity and the natural feeling that some way you had an edge. And he's saying that isn't true. And for us, it's the Word of God. It's the Spirit of the living God working inside of us. And we need to respond to this. Let's not add anything to it. Let's not subtract anything from it. Mysticism, putting too much emphasis on self. There should be no emphasis on self. It's all about what Jesus is doing inside of us. And then he says, Jesus over asceticism in verse 13. You're like, what is that word? I agree. How could they fall victim to that? But they did. They started believing that if they were harsh on themselves, if they started denying themselves and punishing their bodies and keeping it under, that they would be more spiritual, that they would be looked at with greater favor in the eyes of God. And it just isn't true. And so all of these here, legalism and mysticism and asceticism, is all about us. And so the danger for us that we want to have victory over is not falling victim to think that we do anything above and beyond. In him, in Christ alone, I put my trust. In Christ alone, I live this life for him. He ends this thing by saying in verse 23, these have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion and asceticism and severity to the body, but they are of no value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh. All of these things are of no value, but we can have victory in our life every day if we are filled and continue to be filled with the only one who is full. He is the whole fullness. Let's grab onto that power. Let's live the victorious life by being filled and not giving in to worldly influence. Let's be transformed in him through victory over sin. Let's be alive with him for victory over judgment. We can triumph with him and overcome evil. And then let's choose relationship over religion. I don't know how you came in here this morning. I don't know the ways that you've been taught in your entire life. But I want you to know that this is true. It's all about Jesus. Jesus loves you. He gave himself for you. And if you have never put your faith and trust in Jesus, this passage is trying to draw us into that. Choose that relationship. Maybe you came in here today and you've let some external things get into your heart and to rule into your heart. Paul's trying to exhort the people of Colossae. These things should not be, and you're letting them take you captive. If there are some things in your life that have held you captive, you need to turn them over to the Lord and say, forgive me. I want to experience a transformation of sanctification that you can show yourself more alive in Christ. And so our band is going to come and they're going to lead us in a song that just really sings about this. But let me pray for us as a church right now. Dear Father in heaven, I am so grateful that you are a God who is alive and at work. That in you alone, there is hope, there is confidence, there is a way that we can walk about the day of being a transformed person because we're trying to represent you in a way that a lost and dying world can see the difference you make. Father, there's going to be so many worldly influences that try to come in and to take charge of our heart. Help us to be able to fight them off. Help us to see to it that no one takes us captive. And that you will give us that triumphal victory because of all the power that you have and that you're in control. And Father, you love us as your church. So may we be reminded of these truths. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.